Om Prapanna Parijataya Totra Vetraikapanaye Jnana Mudraya Krishnaya Gita Amruta Duhe Namaha Om. Dear friends, welcome to the study of Gita. We are seeing Shloka number 20 of the 7th chapter of Gita. 7th chapter, Jnana Vijnana Yoga. We are seeing the 20th Shloka. That is, Krishna was saying as to why people, they go to different types of, they visualize God in a different form. They were in so many different forms. And the answer he gives is, because of their own nature. You tell me your God, I'll tell you your nature. That's what I was telling you, quoting Tattvavidananda, Swami Tattvavidananda. So like that, people with a different nature. Suppose somebody is very ambitious. He wants to get something out of the way. So he worships a particular type of God in a particular form. He will do some sort of some Shudra Puja or something like that. So people, depending on their own nature, driven by their own nature, they do all that. So what we are seeing here is the idea of God, how this idea of God is being analyzed in a philosophical framework. Krishna is analyzing the idea of God in a philosophical framework and not from the point of view of any religion. Because Brahman is something which is one. Brahman, the supreme reality, is one. But all the people, they are not bothered about their supreme reality. They do not. They are not seekers. They are not knowledge seekers. Knowledge in the sense they do not want to know what is the supreme reality and all that. They want their own desires to be fulfilled. So from that point of view, why people approach different gods means because they are driven by their own nature. They have got so many desires, motivated by their own desires and motivated by their own prakriti. They visualize the God in so many different forms. So that is what Krishna is saying. And what we see here is Vedanta is not actually condemning all these things. In fact, Krishna, in fact, we are going to see in the next shloka also, he is not actually condemning them. But he is saying you are having a limited view of God. What we call a saguna Brahma. We use two words in Vedanta. That is what is called saguna and the other is nirguna. Saguna means that which is having some attributes like srushti, sthiti, laya, creation, sustenance, destruction, and protecting the good people and punishing the bad, etc., etc. That is saguna level. But Vedanta says at the highest level, that highest reality, what we call Brahman, has nothing to do with all these things. That highest reality, Brahman, is something which is nirguna. There are no attributes. There is no action in that. In this saguna Brahma, there is some action. So this nirguna Brahma is what we see at the level of religion. All religions, they talk about, they stop here only. Only Vedanta or Upanishads and Gita, they go to this level. That is nirguna level. And this ideas, this saguna idea, it is basically a belief. Okay, this God is, this is the idea of God. So it is basically a belief. This is what my religion says. This is what my religion says. That is a belief. Whereas in Vedanta, it is not belief, it is inquiry. It is, for example, we have seen how the idea of Brahman, that is Satyam Jnanam Anantam, is very systematically derived. Very systematically, a person reaches to that particular understanding. So that is philosophical understanding. Whereas here, it is belief. Saguna level is something which is to do with belief. And this is again a very limited idea of God, whereas that is the real, absolute, clear idea about that is that supreme reality. So that is what we see in this shloka number 20, which we discussed yesterday in great detail. We have to go to the next shloka 21. This is also a very important shloka. In fact, this is 21st shloka of 7th adhyaya. I quote quite often and I feel that everybody, all the children also, they have to know this. Children also, they have to know this because children also face the questions. Because when your child goes to a school, maybe if you are particularly when you are abroad, and when your child goes to a school, the other school boys or school peers, what is called peer pressure. So those people, they will be saying, oh, you worship so many gods, we have got only one God. Then this boy or girl, he will feel, okay, we belong to some sort of inferior religion. So some sort of what can we say, some sort of diffident attitude develops. So the child also feels, yes, what is all this? There can only be one God. Why we are worshipping so many gods? In fact, this shloka is answering all that. This shloka, 21st shloka, is answering all that. What Krishna says, yo yo yam yam tanum bhaktaha shraddhayarchitum icchati tasya tasya achalam shraddham tameva vidadhamyaham. He says, yo yo yam yam. Yo yo is like in Hindi, jo jo. Jo Admi, like that, yo yo, whoever. Yam yam tanum, in whatever form, tanum is body. Tanu, tanoti vistarayati, tanum is a shape, name, form, let us say. Yo yo yam yam tanum shraddhaha, bhaktaha. A devotee, he may choose whatever, whosoever, whatsoever form. Shraddhaya architamichati. This Shraddha is very important. Shraddha is great devotion, attention. Shraddha is actually hooking your individual mind to a higher and a higher personality. You are visualizing a higher entity called one particular deity, and you are hooking your antahkarana to that. So that is what is Shraddha. It is a sort of connecting link between the individual consciousness and a slightly higher level of consciousness, not that supreme consciousness, but you have visualized some god from something like that, and you are particularly working with a particular intention. I want this, with that particular intention you are worshipping that. So that is what is Shraddha. Bhaktaha Shraddhaya Architum Ichchati. Architum Ichchati means desires to worship. Architum Ichchati. Ichcha means desire. Architum Ichchati means desires to worship. Whoever desires to worship in whatever form, then what is the ultimate, what is that supreme God, what is that supreme level of understanding? Tasya tasya achalam shraddham tameva vidadham yaham. For him, tasya means to that person who is visualizing a God in a particular form. Then I am actually confirming, tameva vidadhami. Vidadhami means I am actually confirming the shreyam shraddha. I am actually allowing it, I am endorsing it, I am conceding to that. I am actually consenting or approving this vidadhami. Vidadhami actually means I am actually confirming or endorsing or consenting or approving. In any all these senses we can take. Tasya achalam shraddham tameva vidadhamyaham. That is, I am confirming that shraddha in him, and I am also going to respond in the same way. Because suppose you visualize a great king or emperor, and that emperor, there are so many small employees, and you are seeking something from those employees, and whatever employees they give, whatever, suppose you have gone to a person who is below that king or emperor, and you have gone to some official, and that official also gives you something, and that official is giving you in the overall system created by that king only, because the king has created a system, and in that system only, through that system only it comes. So that is exactly how we have to understand. Tasya tasya achalam shraddham tameva vidadhami aham. Aham means he is talking from the point of view of that supreme reality. Whenever Krishna says aham, he is not referring to his status as Krishna, son of Vasudeva, etc. He is referring to that supreme reality. So in that supreme reality, what we call that cosmic intelligence. Cosmic intelligence is the first manifestation, and in that cosmic intelligence, all this arrangement is there. You visualize in whatever form, okay, in that form you get result. You visualize in the form of Vishnu, you get the result. You visualize in the form of Shiva, you get the result. You visualize in some other form, Saraswati, you get the result. You visualize in the form of Anjaneya, you get the result. You visualize in the form of Ganesha, you get the result. So it is like that supreme Brahman, if you visualize as a king or somebody who has created this whole system, or this cosmic entity itself, cosmic intelligence itself, what we call Hiranyagarbha. There is a technical name for that cosmic intelligence. It is called Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha literally means, Hiranya means gold, Garbha means womb, Hiranyagarbha means golden womb. Probably the word also is very, very significant in the sense that what all God forms we visualize, they are actually from this, visualized from this Hiranyagarbha only. That Hiranyagarbha is Actually, the source for all these God forms, we visualize, whatever God we visualize is in that, from that cosmic intelligence only you are visualizing some form. So that is the, and in this whole system of Hiranyagarbha, there is a system of prayer and answer. You are doing a prayer and there is somebody who is answering. And you visualize in a particular form, in that particular form, the system is answering. You visualize in some other form, in that form, the system is answering. So there is a system created. That is what Krishna is saying. Tasya tasya achalam shraddham tameva vidathamyaham means, I am actually responding to him in the same manner. In whatever form he is visualizing, in whatever manner he is visualizing, I am responding, I am confirming the same thing to him. Confirming, I am actually consenting, I am agreeing to that. So this is what we see. So what exactly, in fact, name and form, they are not important. The essence, that is what is important. So that is what we see here in this shloka. That is, in fact, one of my Vedanta teachers, he used to tell a story. And that story is like this. In olden days, even now probably, you know, in some festivals, in several festivals, we prepare sugar dolls. We prepare sugar dolls, and those sugar dolls, one doll is in the shape of a parrot, another dog is in the shape of a hen, another doll is in the shape of a dog, another doll in the shape of a pig, another doll in the shape of a donkey, etc., etc. And suppose you are giving those things, and suppose a child, he sees that pig, say, I don't want pig, it says, I don't want pig, I want this, say, parrot. And somebody wants something like a peacock, somebody likes a peacock, but you don't want a dog, you don't want a pig or anything like that, you all want peacock, etc. An older boy is there, okay, I will take that dog, I will take that pig. And then suppose the father says, oh, okay, are you happy with this dog? Okay, he says, I don't mind, because he knows that whether it is a doll, whether it is a peacock, or whether it is a parrot, or whether it is a hen, or whether it is a pig, it is all sugar only. So that is what is the idea of an enlightened person. Whereas an unenlightened person, he is worried about the dolls, he is worried about the shape, he is worried about the name and form. So this shloka is telling that we have to go beyond the names and forms. And we are not condemning these names and forms. That is again we have to see. Why we have not condemned the names and what is the result of that? We will just take a break and resume. We will discuss it. Let us resume. We see in this shloka, that is yo yo yam yam tanum bhaktaha. In this shloka, we see that our system is allowing all types of traditions. All types of traditions means tradition of worship. It may be worship of Shiva, it may be worship of Vishnu, it may be worship of Ganesha, it may be worship of some Grama Devata, or it may be worship of some other Devata in some peculiar form. If you go to some places in Assam, etc., there are some other peculiar systems. So all those peculiar, not only Assam, everywhere, even here, there are so many ways of worship. We have allowed all that because it doesn't matter, because in all these things, the ultimate reality is only one. And depending on one's own nature, a person is worshipping all these things. So this is what answers the question, why we have so many gods? Because we have not condemned them, we have allowed them to exist. We have allowed them to exist and we have not condemned them. And there is a philosophical understanding in all these things. In fact, one Upanishad says that a person cannot directly understand and devote his attention to the supreme reality. Everybody can't do that. Only a person who is slightly educated, and then a person who is able to think, who is able to analyze the question, who am I? So only such person may be able to make some progress. And also a person who has that ability to self-disciplining. You may be a great scholar, but you may not have self-discipline. So that self-discipline, that antahkarana shuddhi, so with all that, then a person may be able to hold on to that bigger thing. But all other people who are guided by their own emotions, guided by their own nature, they would like to visualize a god in whatever form they want. And our system has allowed all these things. Because that Upanishad, Ramatapaniya Upanishad, it says, Chinmayasya Advitiyasya Nishkalasya Ashariirinaha. Chinmayasya Advitiyasya Nishkalasya Ashariirinaha. Upasakanam Karyartham Brahmano Rupakalpana. Upasakanam Karyartham Brahmano Rupakalpana. Brahmanaha Rupakalpana means you are visualizing a rupa. You are kalpana. Kalpana means visualizing. You are visualizing a rupa. You are visualizing a form for that Brahman. Why? Upasakanam Karyartham. In order to fulfill the desires of a upasaka. A bhakta. Upasaka means bhakta, let us say. Suppose some bhakta wants something. So you have visualized a form called Saraswati. You have visualized a form called Ganesha. Or you have visualized a form called Hayagriva. And from that Hayagriva, you are seeking all Jnanaanandamayam Devam Nirmala Spatikakrutim. We say, okay, we worship Hayagriva for all vidyas, for all education. See, in some other system, some other man is worshipping Saraswati for the same education, for vidya. So like that, all these forms, upasakanam karyartham, you have visualized all these forms, it may be male, female, male and female, both are there. So whatever may be the form, whatever may be the name, you have visualized all these things in one reality. And what is that reality? The first line says, Chinmayasya Advitiyasya. Chinmaya. Chinmaya means the very name Chinmayananda. What is Chinmaya? That is Chit is consciousness. It is pure consciousness. Advitiya. Advitiya means non-dual. It is only one. Advitiyasya. Nishkalasya. There are no parts in that. There are no divisions. It is not an avayavi. Avayavi means a person who is having a body and limbs and all that. If you visualize God as a person, then that God will be a limited person. So, Nishkalasya, Ashariirinaha, making it very clear that there is no Sharira, there is no body. So, it is all pure consciousness which is pervading. So, in that, you are visualizing a form. For what? Basically, because our own nature and we want to fulfill our needs. So, because of a philosophical understanding, we have allowed all these forms. So, that is what we have to understand. If somebody says, why we have so many gods, etc., etc., that is because human desires are so many. And humans, depending on their own nature, they try to seek so many things. And that is the reason why we follow all these things. So, this basically explains. And it also explains the very egalitarian tradition. That liberal outlook and then that tolerant outlook. Why we tolerate all these various things, so many forms and all that. And basically that is because of a philosophical understanding. We don't bother if some other religion says, oh, this is our God, etc. We are not bothered. So long as they don't come to our doorstep and then force us to worship their God, we are not bothered. Okay, let them worship. Let them worship some other God. We are not bothered. But if you contrast it, or if you compare and contrast it with what happened in other parts of the world, if we see, in other parts of the world, when a new religion came up, it destroyed all the existing religions. You make your own analysis. When a new religion came, it destroyed what all was existing. But here, all these systems were not destroyed. They were harmonized. All these systems, they were not destroyed. They were all harmonized. That is the reason why, for example, Shankaracharya is called Shanmatasthapanacharya. During Shankaracharya's time, there were so many traditions in the country. And Shankaracharya was a man who toured all over the country and had discussions with so many scholars. And he saw there are certain prominent traditions like Shiva, Vishnu, and then Shakti, and then Ganesha, Sun God, Surya. And Skanda, so many forms, six were predominant forms, and many other things. There were again variations of these things only, variations of Shiva, variations of Skanda, variations of Vishnu. So like that, there are so many variations. So he formalized, he said, and he also examined some of these non-Vedic or Avaidika systems. That is somebody sitting on dead bodies and doing some worship. Dead bodies and doing some worship, etc., it is something which is not there in the Vedas. But then in society it is there. We see, there are so many practices in the society which are not there in the Vedas. So avaidika. So Shankaracharya condemned all these avaidika things. And then he said, okay, yes, these six systems, these are the prominent systems. And many other things, many other forms, they fall in these categories, six forms only. For example, somebody says, some Vaishnavi Devi. Vaishnavi Devi comes under Shakti only. Some other place, Kamakhya, comes under Shakti only. In some other place, some other form of Shiva, for example, Dakshinamurti, another form of Shiva only. So like that, Rama, another form of Vishnu, Krishna, another form of Vishnu. So these six systems, he formalized, he said, these are the things which can be permitted or which can be brought under this Vedic system. And he wrote stotrams in praise of all these people. And when he praised Ganesha, he said Ganesha is the supreme. And when he praised Shiva, he said Shiva is the supreme. Because he wanted to see that supreme in that form. Another devotee of Ganesha, he wants to see the supreme in the form of Ganesha. Another person wants to see the supreme in the form of Shakti. Another person wants to see the supreme in the form of Vishnu. So like that, he wrote praises or stotrams in praise of all these forms. And our rishis also, they also did a very wise thing. They also established some sort of relationship among these gods. For example, we see that Shiva and Shakti. Shakti, we said it is Parvati, and then Shiva and Parvati, we got them married. And Ganesha, we said he is the Skanda, son of Shiva. And we also said Skanda take Muruga, whatever Muruga or Skanda, we called him the son of Shiva. And again Vishnu again said to be the brother of Shakti. So like that we have made them into a family, grouped all these people into a family. So like that our sages did a wise thing in harmonizing various things. They did not want to destroy. The basic thing we have to understand is, in other parts of the world, they went about destroying, whereas we did not destroy, we allowed all these things. In fact, we built up, somehow we did some harmonization, we means our sages, people like Vyasa, people like Valmiki we don't see much, but in Vyasa, we see this entire effort. Vyasa was a very great social reformer, and this sort of social engineering, what we call nowadays, was done by Vyasa, Krishna, and also Shankaracharya. All these people, they were all great social engineers. So, and Shankaracharya, as I said, he was called Shanmata Sthapanacharya. So, this is the reason why we have got this system of so many gods. And these people, they don't hate. For example, one family, for example, my own family, suppose four or five people, we go to a temple. My son may like a particular god form. My wife may like a particular god form. I may like another particular god form. And in the house also, okay, I do some type of prayer. My wife does some other Lalita Sahasranama. My son may do something else. So like that, in one same family, we have so many types of worship. And we have absolutely no problem. And the follower of Vishnu, for example, a Kattar Vaishnava, let us say, hardcore Vaishnava, who sees only Srimad Bhagavatam and doesn't see anything else. He sees that, yes, Lord Vishnu is the greatest. He is the only, that supreme reality, what we call Brahman in Vedanta. But he does not condemn Shiva. He says Shiva is his good friend. If you see Bhagavatam particularly, where Daksha Yajnam, etc. is discussed in Bhagavatam also. In that Daksha Yajna, Shiva is praised very much. And Shiva, when Vishnu appears, Shiva also greets him. He does some namaste to him. So they treat Shiva as somebody who is just next to number two. But Shiva is not condemned as a devil or a demon or something like that. So similarly, followers of Shiva, they treat Vishnu as a very great good friend of Shiva. They don't treat Vishnu as a demon or a devil. So this sort of understanding, the Kattar Shaiva does not hate Vishnu. A Kattar Vaishnava does not hate Shiva. So similarly, it extends to all other people also, because these two are very predominant traditions. And a Kattar Shakteya also, he doesn't condemn these forms. Shakteya, he will say, from Shakti only this Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, they appeared. So he also accepts these people. So like that, a sort of harmonization was done in Indian society. So this is what we have to remember from this shloka. It is a wonderful shloka. And in fact, this is as per the philosophy which we see in the Upanishads. In our Upanishads, we see there are so many mantras. For example, all these mantras we see in the prayers also. When you go to a temple and when you see this mantra, Uttaranarayanam, this also I repeated. I quoted this line several times. That is, at the end of Uttaranarayanam, we see Sabrahma Sashivas Saharise Indrasotsharah Paramaswarat. What you call that Pratyagatma, that is what is Shiva, that is what is Brahma, that is what is Indra, that is what is Akshara Brahma. So similarly, when we say Mantra Pushpam, in that Mantra Pushpam also it says, Tvam Brahma, Tvam Rudraha, Tvam Prajapatihi, etc., etc. You are that Brahma, you are that, you are that. That means all forms are one. So this is the philosophy of the Upanishads, which is shown in this Gita also. So this is what we have to understand. We have absolutely no dispute with other religions. In fact, other religions, they have a dispute with us because they want to eradicate this religion, which is the only tolerant religion. And this tolerance, again, coming back to this word called tolerance and there is another word, liberalism and all that. These are not the gift of some Western thought. This is not the gift of some Western thought or anything. This is the gift of Upanishads. From Upanishads only people in the West, the 18th century enlightenment was because of interaction with Upanishads. This is one point on which many Indian scholars, they have to do research. That is, interaction with Upanishads created, resulted in that enlightenment, 18th century enlightenment, what we call the age of enlightenment. And many philosophers, Western philosophers like Schopenhauer and later several people, and American people like Emerson, Thoreau and all these people, they were all deeply influenced by the Indian philosophy. So this is what we have to remember. Not much research has been done on this subject. So what we have to understand is, when somebody says, oh, you have got so many gods and all that, we have to only say, we have not killed them, we have not destroyed them, we have harmonized all of them. So that is the reason. We have absolutely no dispute with any other people. So that is what we have to remember. It's a very important shloka, which has got a lot of sociological implication. Every child has to understand it. Then the 22nd shloka, it again Krishna says, yes, you worship any form. Who is the person who is giving the result? As I said, the whole system is like, so you have got an emperor or a king, and the king, there are so many functionaries, and you go to a functionary and then seek something and you get something. You go to another man, you get something. But the entire thing, it is because of the system. It is because of the system created by that king. So that is what he is saying in that 22nd shloka. That is, Sataya Shraddhaya Yuktaha Tasya Aradhana Mihate Labhatecha Tatah Kaman Mayaiva Vihitan Hitan. In all these cases, the result is given by me only. That is what he says, that cosmic intelligence. He is speaking from the point of view of that cosmic intelligence or cosmic being. We will see this tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.